Hi everybody. So today we will discuss the balance part of the deductible expenses. So as we discussed already, in expense in calculating the business income and the investment income, we already covered section 10. The section 10 is to provide disallowable items. Then we move on to the section 11. There are two parts in section 11. The section 11 subsection 1 we discussed. Any expense incurred in the production of income of a business or investment could be deductible. But under section 11 subsection 2, if expense of a capital nature, you can't claim that expense. Then we discuss section 12 on the specific deduction on the interest cost. Section 13, allowance for trading stock. So now we will look at the section 14, the repair and improvements. So here in the specific deductions. So as I told you earlier, when you come to specific deductions, the general rule doesn't apply. So for expense of a repair and improvement, the deduction should be allowed under section 14. It's a repair and improvement, both repair and improvement, or repair or improvement. What do you mean by repair? What do you mean by improvement? You want, just for a understanding purpose, you can evaluate what do you mean by repair and improvement. The repair is basically, let's say something got damaged. By repairing, what you are expecting is to, you are going to bring the asset into a previous operating condition. You are going to add the value. There won't be value increase after repair. You are going to bring the asset into the previously operating condition. For example, let's say car got damaged by accident. By repair, what you are expecting? You are going to bring back the car into a previous condition, no? Nothing more than that. So generally repairs are considered to be revenue in nature expense. But improvement? No. The improvement is something that you are adding value to the asset. Maybe you are going to have certain new modification to the existing asset. Or sometimes you are going to increase the useful lifetime of the asset. So improvements are normally capital nature cost. But this section says whether it's an expense of capital nature or not, the repair or improvements are deductible expense. On what? On the depreciable assets. So what do you mean by depreciable asset? So as we discussed under section 195, we discuss any realization of depreciable asset, the income should be taxable, no, as a part of business income. Going to section 6, where we discuss what do you mean by depreciable asset. So depreciable asset is basically the any asset which is employed in the production of income of the business. As a result of usage, value comes down due to wear and tear, obsolescence or passing of time. They are basically the machinery, building, furnitures, plants, vehicles. So those you can consider as a depreciable asset. So on those depreciable asset, any repair and improvement cost will be deductible expense under section 14 of the Revenue Act. But it says in subsection 2, the deduction shall not exceed, there is a maximum ceiling you can claim. It is depending on the category of the asset. The case of class 4 depreciable asset, what do you mean by class 4 depreciable asset? We will discuss just after this 2-3 sections after, or 2 sections after. The fourth schedule is on the depreciable asset or depreciation allowance or capital allowance, where you identify the depreciable asset. There are 5 categories of depreciable asset. If you look at the fourth schedule, out of the fourth schedule, all these 5 categories, the category 4 or class 4 asset, basically class 4 assets are buildings and permanent structure, etc. So when repair and improvements are incurred on the class 4 asset, the maximum you can claim is 5% of your written down value at the end of the previous year of assessment, not at the end of the current year of assessment. If you're going to allow the deduction for 2019-20, you must find out the depreciable asset, the written down value, at the beginning of the current year of assessment or at the end of the previous year of assessment, that is on 31st March 2018. For example, for a 2019-20 claim, you must take the depreciable asset written down value as a 31st March 2019, end of 1890. Okay. We'll work out some examples, don't worry. But in relation to all the other classes, that's class 1, class 2, class 3, and class 5, the maximum repair and improvement deduction will be restricted to 20% of the written down value of the previous year of assessment, at the end of the previous year of assessment. The basically rule is, you might take the ceiling, it could be in the case of class 4 asset 5%, in case of other classes of assets 20% of the written down value, obviously test written down value, at the end of the previous year of assessment. Okay. A test written down value is basically the cost minus the capital allowance that you already claimed. Remaining amount for capital allowance claim. So in this case, if the actual expense is less than this particular ceiling, you can claim the whole amount. But actual expense is more than this particular ceiling, the maximum claim is 5% or 20%. So what will happen to the excess? Says the excess expense shall not be allowed, but shall be added to the depreciation basis of the asset. So the excess amount which are not allowed under this section will be added to the depreciation basis of the asset here. But depreciation basis, in other words, you add it to the cost of the asset. The depreciation basis, this is the basis, the amount on which you claim capital allowances. We'll discuss after some, we'll discuss section 16. In other words, any unclaimed repair and improvement cost will not be lost, will be added to the depreciation basis, and thereafter you can claim on that cost capital allowances thereafter under section 16. Okay. Yes. Look at the application check 38. To just find out the discernible amount of following cost and repairment improvement cost for a year of assessment 1920. Take example, the machinery, the written down value for 1920, the amount to be claimed, you must take the end of the previous year of assessment written down value. Let's say that is 31st March 2019, 1819 hint, 25 million, but our actual cost is 4 million. The building 30 million, but cost is 2,500,000. For the disallowed amount, so actual cost is 4 billion. The case of machinery, but maximum you can claim it's coming under other classes, not class 4. Maximum claim you can claim 20% of the written down value. So 20% written down value of 25 million comes to 5 million rupees, but the actual cost is 4 million. The whole thing you can claim, nothing to disallow. It is less than the upper ceiling. But in the case of building, your actual cost is 2,500,000, but your maximum you can claim the class 4 asset, written down value 30 million, 5% on that, 1,500,000. So there is a 1 million rupees excess. The 2,500,000 minus 1,500,000. The excess of 1 million you have to disallow under this section, and later on it will be added to the cost of the asset. Is that clear? Look at another question. The application check 39. A company has incurred the repair expense of 1 million for the year of 1920 in respect to the machinery acquired during the year 1719. Test written down value of this machinery as of 31st March 2019 amounting to 4 million rupees. So advise the deductible amount of repair expense for the year past 1920. So here the question comes, if you look at this question, this asset was acquired in 2017-18. So when you come to 17-18, at the time of acquisition, we claim capital allowances under the previous Indian Revenue Act. According to previous Indian Revenue Act, under section 25 of the previous act, you could claim capital allowance only on the cost of the asset under section 25 of the previous act. So therefore, this particular ceiling, the rule, is it apply for this asset? Questionable. So look at the answer. The repair expense may be allowed as it is not subject to any limitation under section 214. Because this expense was incurred in relation to the asset acquired prior to 1st April 2018. The reason why I am saying is, look at the account of the transitional provision. The capital allowance shall be deducted on the cost of the asset for the remaining period after 1/4/2018 on this asset. No, we discussed the first day. Even any asset acquired prior to 1st April 2018, once you claim capital allowance under the previous act, you continue to claim the capital asset, the capital allowances under the previous act, even after 1st April 2018 on the same cost. Therefore, in this case, the excess amount capitalization will not be applicable here. So why? If you are going to apply this rule, you must change your cost. So law doesn't allow you to change the cost according to the transitional provision. So there, what I am trying to say here is, this rule could be applied effectively for the assets acquired after 1st April 2018 under the current Indian Revenue Act. Okay. Law is silent about that, but it's understood. When you're going to claim the capital allowance under the previous act through transitional provision, you can't vary the cost. But you're going to apply in section 14, in excess repair and improvement cost, you must add it to the cost. You are varying the cost. So you can't do that turn according to the transitional provision. So that is the reason I am trying to tell you, yeah, this rule could be applied only for the asset acquired after 1st April 2018. Okay. Look at another question, 40. Application check, 40. Yeah, I taken one asset. I tried to claim capital losses over the period of useful life of the asset. A company has acquired a machinery for a 5 million rupees during the year of 1920. So it anticipates the machinery will have to be repaired with a cost of 1 million in the year 2020-21, 21-22, 2 years time. So the original cost is 5 million in 1920. It anticipates the repair cost of 1 million in 2021-22. Look at how we are going to claim. So look at the how we are going to claim the capital loss for useful life of the asset. How do you treat the repair cost of 1 million rupees? Year of assessment, depreciation basis, that's the cost. When you claim capital losses, number of years you can claim the depreciation or capital loss, cumulative depreciation or cumulative capital loss. What I meant here, a depreciation is a capital allowance, okay? Under section 16, we are going to discuss that one in two sections out. So, year of acquisition 1920, the cost is 5 million, that is our depreciation basis. We go to section 16 after some time. First schedule claim, so number of years, 5 years, so annual capital allowance is 1 million, so cumulative capital allowance also 1 million. 2021, second year, your written on value is 4 million, you can claim over balance 4 years. Again, capital allowance is 1 million in 2021. The cumulative capital allowance is 2 million rupees. 21-22, 3 million, around 3 million, 5 million minus capital allowance claim 2 million, 3 million, you claim over 3 years, 1 million. But though you incur the expense in 21-22, you can capitalize in the same year. Then you are going to claim double, no? Part of the repair improvement cost you are going to claim under section 14. Once you add it to the cost, you claim the same year capital allowance also. Therefore, it's understood that you can capitalize into the subsequent year of assessment. Should have been 2 million, the written off value, but 400,000 excess. I'll work out for the excess. How we take the excess? Yeah, the excess repair cost in 21-22, 1 million minus 21-22, 3 million by the end of the year of assessment. How? 3 million? The 5 million minus capital allowances, cumulative capital allowances, 2 million. Therefore, at the beginning of the financial year, 2021, only 600,000. 3 million into 20%. So 1 million minus 600,000. Out of 1 million, you could claim 600,000 repair cost under section 14. The 400,000 will be added back, not in the same financial year, subsequent financial year 22-23. That's the reason the 2 million became 2,400,000. You see. So the 2,400,000 you must divide over 2 years. So balance capital allowances is 1,200,000. So cumulative capital allowances become 4,200,000. The last year, so out of 5 million you are claim already, plus 400,000 capitalized cost, you already claim 4,200,000. So written down value 1,200,000, that you are claiming within the next financial year. divide by 1. So all 1,200,000, so you can claim. So that is the way you are going to claim the capital allowances under the new act. Yeah, we'll discuss again this one under section 16 after some times. Are you clear? So this example shows very clearly how we are going to claim capital allowances on the same asset over the period of time. Okay? Not like the previous act. The previous act, you claim capital allowance on the cost of the asset with the percentage. The rate is given as a percentage. But here, you claim capital allowance on the depreciation basis. It can vary, mostly cost, but it can vary. And also, you are going to claim based on number of years remaining. So, I will come to section 15 of the act. As you will look at the section 15, there are two parts there. One is the research and development expenses, other one, agriculture startup expenses. To clarify this one in detail, I thought of to have it in two different discussion. First, you look at the R&D. Claim R&D expense claimable under section 15. What you can claim is not only the research development also under this section. But there is no definition given under the Ilaravani Act for research and development. You can normally apply the standard definition. Generally, research and development goes together, no? But actually speaking, research is something, development is something. Research, by doing the research, what you are expecting is to innovate, try to innovate something, no? Research might succeed, research might fail. If you succeed, then you develop the product. That's a development cost. So the development is, there's a outcome. For research, we don't know what going to be the outcome. So, with the research expense only your research plus development expenses, you can claim under section 15 of the Ilaravani Act. Okay? Here again, mostly, even if you incur a capital nature, you can claim. With a capital nature or not, regardless of section 11, subsection 2, whether the research and development expense are, if it is incurred for the production of income, you can claim whether that expense is a capital nature or not. So, very interesting to see how they are defined the word phrase research and development expenses. The research and development expenses means the expense incurred by the person. There are two things given here. For A, cover research part. B covers development part. In case of research, carrying out any scientific, industrial, agriculture or any other research. I think almost all the research are covered. For upgrading of the person's business through an institution in Sri Lanka. Or for innovation or research relating to any high value agricultural products by the person or through any research institution in Sri Lanka. So, within bracket is not so necessary also, I believe. So, already covered. When you say scientific, agricultural, industrial and any other research, you can cover. The whole research expense you can cover under this. How they define the development? The process of developing the person's business and improving business products or process. So, if you are developing your business, if you develop your business process or you improve your business products or services by re-engineering or otherwise. So, the development expenses also remember deductible under section 15, whole amount. But there is exclusion here. shall be beneficial to Sri Lanka, but shall exclude. I mean, this is not a research and development. What is that? Any expense incurred that are otherwise included in the cost of the asset. There may be any research and development expense if you add it to the cost of the asset to the depreciation basis. Since you are claiming capital allowance on the cost, you can claim under section 15 the same amount as research and development. So therefore, any uncapitalized or non-capitalized expenditure only you can claim as a research and development expense under section 15. But look at the previous set, it's not that way. Even a capitalized asset also, without claiming capital allowance, you can claim whole expenditure under research and research expense. But current act says it prohibits. If you capitalize the asset, then that capitalized amount, though it's a research expense, it is not a research expense for the purpose of section 15. That means you can't claim. Okay? So importantly, once you claim the research expense under section, research and development expense under section 15, this implication of section 6th schedule also. We go to 6th schedule, the last schedule of the Ilaravani Act. The title is temporary concession. When the government introduced this new act, they want to give for certain sectors concession for a short period. Mostly 3 years, some of 5 years. So what is trying to say here? Under 6th schedule, a person who is entitled to an additional deduction when calculating the person's income from business for a year of assessment equal to 100% of total amount of research and development expenses under section 15 for 3 years of assessment after commencement of this act. So what has happened here actually speaking? Because on the previous act, we had a double claim of research expense, double deduction. But here there is no double deduction under section 15, only single deduction. Therefore, the government given a short term concession only for 3 years, we could claim a double deduction. Provided it should be a research expenses, research and development expense for the purpose of section 15. If you're going to claim an amount under section 15 as a deductible expenses, the same amount you can claim again, not under section 15 as per 6th schedule. So basically, if you are going to claim the expense as 100 million rupees, we could claim 200 million rupees. But 100 million under section 15, another 100 million as per 6th schedule. Okay? Look at the application check 41. A company has incurred research expense 4,500,000, especially industrial research through an institution in Sri Lanka. It also incurs 1 million rupees in improving the business process. On the face of it, 4,500,000 is research, 1 million is development cost. What is the amount to be deductible in calculating the business income? So, all 5,500,000 research and development expense you can claim as follows. Total sum of 5,500,000 you can claim as expense under section 15 under the heading research and development. Then same amount 5,500,000 you can claim as per 6th schedule temporary concessions. Therefore effectively you are going to claim 11 million rupees, double the claim. Okay. Look at application check 42. A company has incurred research expense of 3 million to acquire equipment to the laboratory to carry out the research. So this equipment was acquired to carry out the research, but you capitalized the balance sheet. So question comes whether you can claim this amount as a deductible expense under section 15 along with the temporary concession. What is the answer? Yes or no? Look at the definition of the research expense under section 15. It says, having defined research and development expense, it says shall exclude any amount otherwise including the cost of the asset. So this here, the whole 3 million rupees is capitalized, it's added to the cost of the asset. Therefore, it's not a research expense for the purpose of section 15. Consequently, you can't claim temporary concession also. You are losing both sides. Why? So you could claim capital allowances at the given rate under section 16. Okay. The capitalized cost to the asset, you can't claim as a research expense or development expense. So very clear. The definition of research and development expense shall exclude the expense incurred that are otherwise included in the cost of an asset. Therefore, the cost of the 3 million rupees incurred is not research expense for the purpose of section 15. However, company can deduct capital allowance on the cost of the asset under section 16. But you can claim temporary concession also, is understood. Now again, same section, agriculture startup expense. This expense again we had in the previous act also, slightly different definition here. So what is called agricultural startup expenses? If they are incurred in the production of income, may be deducted irrespective of whether they are capital nature or not. Here again, this supersede the prohibition of capital nature expense. So what do you mean by agriculture startup expense? Means the expense incurred by the person in opening up of a land for cultivation or animal husbandry. This is a unique expense for these sectors. If you are doing cultivation or animal husbandry, farming, good example. In this business, what is the major part of your asset in your business? The land. For example, if you do a cultivation business, agriculture business, can you buy a land today and cultivate tomorrow? I don't think, no. Take a good example, let's say you are going to buy a block of land for paddy cultivation in remote area in Kurnool district. Today you buy. So once you buy, you will do a massive expenses to be incurred to bring the land into a cultivatable purpose. For example, sometime you may have to cut the trees grown there. Have access roads to the field, construct irrigation canals, wells, construct fences, butcher's hut. So huge amount of expense are incurred. Most of these are capital nature expense also. Nevertheless, you can claim as a opening up of land expense. Who can claim this? Not all the businesses. The people engage in agriculture or animal husbandry. There's a land setting up expense, fully you can claim whole amount. The other is clear. If you going to start this business, cultivation business, the initial year there will be huge account tax loss, no? Why? Some of this expense would have been capitalized to the balance sheet, but for tax purposes, you release to the income statement as a deductible expense. Okay. Cultivating land with referred to in paragraph A with plants. So cultivation of land with plants. In other words, cultivation expenses you can claim. If you don't give this deduction, one can take up the position. The cultivation expense is a capital nature expense. Why? If you cultivate, it gives the enduring benefit to the company. There is a capital nature expense. You can't claim under section 11, subsection 2. But here, though it's capital nature expense, the cultivation expense, you can claim as a agriculture startup expense. It's whole amount as a deductible expense under section 15. Okay? The cultivation expense could be replanting or same plant or different plant, doesn't matter. The purchase of livestock or poultry to be reared on the land. The purchase of livestock, that is applicable for animal husbandry. For example, you can say you are doing farming, chicken. When you buy, how do you record that in inventory? So livestock accounting would have learned, though you account it as a non-current, as a current assets. So actual consumption you charge to the P&L account, right? Income statement. That's for accounting purpose. But there's a taxation, there's a difference. Keep in mind that. What is that? What you can claim is not the consumption, purchased, purchase cost. There, what is charged in the income statement is a consumption. You must add back the consumption and claim the actual purchase cost during the year. If they are used or not, doesn't matter. How do you convert the purchase into, how do you convert the consumption into purchase? One way of doing is, you add back the consumption what is charged in the income statement, find out the purchase and claim it. Or you do that same adjustment through inventory, no? Claim the close inventory amount, add back the opening inventory. So then you convert the consumption into purchase. Then D, maintaining tanks or ponds or clearing or preparation of any inland waters for the rearing of fish and purchase of fish to be reared in such tank, pond or inland waters as the case may be. Is for a fishing, inland fishing. Any maintenance of tanks, clearing and preparation of inland waters, and purchase of fish for rearing purpose, again purchase, not the consumption, you can claim. So very clear in that case, the agriculture startup expenses is defined as exhaustive definition covering A to D. A, commonly for cultivation and animal husbandry, all the expense incurred for opening up of land, you can claim. B, only for cultivation expense, you can claim. C, for poultry, personal livestock could be claimable. D, for inland waters, inland fishing projects, there are certain items can be claimable, including the purchase cost of fish. Okay? Look at example 43, application check 43. Let's say a newly incorporated company which commits the business of cultivating vegetables and fruits has incurred certain expenses in 2019-20. Cost incurred to purchase land for cultivation 40 million. Cost of clearing the land for cultivation 7 million. Cost of construction of fences 700,000. Cost of cultivation 5,200,000. Can you claim these expenses? So there may not be revenue now, you see. There may not be revenue. Because the cultivation expenses, when you incur, you don't get a harvest. Revenue might come sometime after, sometimes. So until that time, you must incur the cultivation expenses. It was a new company. So there's no need to have a revenue to claim the expenses, remember. If a business oriented expenses, you can say it's incurred the production of income. Remember, the income in the productive income doesn't mean there should be revenue to claim the expense. It's wrong. Even there is no revenue, but if the expenses are incurred for the business purposes, you could claim as expense incurred in the production of income. What is important to claim the expense is the existence of the business, not the revenue. Okay? Look at how you are going to claim this. Can you claim the land? 40 million? No. The opening up of land expense you can claim, but not the land cost itself. That's capital cost you can't claim. So other expenses, I think the clearing land for cultivation, construction of fences, these two are, you can say, opening up of land expense for cultivation purpose. And cultivation expense also you can claim. So these three, you can claim under section 15 as agriculture startup expenses. But you see, sometime in your plantation company, the cultivation expense you would have categorized a different heading, no? Immature plantation, you capitalize first and you amortize the income statement. But what is claimable is not amortized amount charged to the income statement. You add back the amortized amount charged to the income statement. Claim the actual amount capitalized to the current asset as a cultivation expense. On the nursery account, look at the nursery account breakup. The real addition during the year, it's a balance sheet item. Cultivation expense you can claim. The immature plantation also same. Take the breakup of the account, the balance sheet item. The new addition is a cultivation expense you can claim. Okay. So now we'll come to the bigger claim, the capital allowance. Again, there are two claims here. One is a capital allowance under section 16, the other one is a balancing allowance again under section 16. First, you look at the capital allowance. When calculated the person's income from business, the capital allowance shall be deducted. It's a must to claim the capital allowance. The previous act was named as a depreciation allowance. The new act given as a wording, not depreciation allowance, capital allowance. It clarifies what do you mean by capital allowance. The capital allowances are granted in respect to depreciable asset owned and used by a person at the end of the year of first month in the production of income from a business. Lot of thing to be discussed here. You can claim capital allowance on what? On depreciable asset. You have to go to section 195 again, as we discussed earlier, the meaning for depreciation, depreciable asset. To go to the definition, the depreciation asset is basically any asset which are employed in the production of income of a business. It loses value due to wear and tear, obsolescence or passing of time. Like a machinery, plant, furnitures, buildings, motor vehicles. So are depreciable assets, very good examples. So on those assets you can claim capital allowance. So condition is, there are two conditions to claim capital allowance. What are they? You must own the depreciable asset and you must use the asset at the end of the year of assessment, by the end of the year of assessment. You should have owned, you must have acquired or owned, you should be the owner of the asset. Plus, you must use the asset by the end of the year of assessment. There may be sometime you acquire the asset, you own the asset but not used. You can't claim capital allowance. Sometime you use the asset, not owned. You take example, you buy a machinery by end of the financial, almost towards the end of the financial year. In March 2020, you bought a machine for 100 million. By end of the year of assessment, you still install the machinery. You use the machine in May 2021. By end of the year of assessment, 1920, you own the asset. But can you claim capital allowance? No. Why? We are not used even for a single day. You know, one day if you use, that is enough by the end of the year of assessment. You can claim the whole annual capital allowance. But you are not used, you can't claim. There are good accounting practice, you should have capitalized as a, not as a provision plant equipment. You should have capitalized as a work in progress, no? But nevertheless, the accounting treatment, technically you can't claim because you are not used the asset by the end of the year of assessment. Similarly, you have a usage but no ownership. Let's say you are taking asset on hiring terms, machinery, to use in your production. You use the asset physically but you can't claim. Why? We are not owner of the asset. So both should satisfy. What are they? You must own the asset and you must use the asset by the end of the year of assessment, the production of income. So capital allowances are calculated as per second or fourth schedule to this act. There are two schedules for the capital allowances claim under section 16. Second schedule, fourth schedule. We'll first discuss fourth schedule and thereafter second schedule. Before discussing second or fourth schedule, I would like to emphasize here section 49(2), it's one exception. Yeah. Where the asset is leased under the finance leasing. So generally, the leasing company is the owner of the asset, not the lessee. Lessee get the ownership after payment of final installment or lease rentals. Under bargain purchase option, automatically the ownership will be transferred, no? But you capitalize the lessee, but you are not owner of the asset. But under the previous set, lessor can claim capital allowance of the leasing assets, finance leasing, not the lessee, though the lessee capitalized the asset. But the new act is goes in line with the accounting standard. It says, in the case of finance leasing, the lessor shall be treated as transferring the ownership of the asset to the lessee. Shall be treated as transferring the ownership. Therefore, go in line with the accounting standard. See, the lessee claiming or lessee capitalizing the asset, lessee can claim capital allowance under this particular rule. Okay? We discuss this part when we discuss the transitional provision, no? accordingly, the lessee is entitled to deduct the capital advance in relation to the assets obtained under finance leasing. It's a conclusion. Now look at the schedules. First schedule, it's on the capital allowances, the balancing allowance and the assessor charge. Clause 1. Can you take the first schedule, please? I'm reading for you. First schedule heading is the capital allowances, balancing allowance and assessor charge. Look at first capital allowance. The item 1 deals with classification of the depreciable asset. There are 5 classes of depreciable assets. Class 1, computers and data handling equipment together with the peripheral devices. Class 2, buses and minibuses, goods vehicles, construction and earth moving equipment, heavy general purpose or specialized trucks, trailers and trailer mounted containers, plant and machinery used in manufacturing. These heavy machineries are covered here. Class 3, railroad cars, locomotives and equipment, vessels, barges, tugs and similar water transportation equipment, aircraft, specialized public utility plant, equipment and machinery, office furniture, fixtures and equipment, any depreciable asset which are not covered in another category or another class. Any depreciable asset, if you are not given under any of the class, you must bring it under class 3. Class 4, buildings, structures and similar works of a permanent nature. Class 5, intangible assets excluding goodwill. So these are the classes, you see. There we discussed already under repair and improvement, no? In relation to class 4 asset, you could claim maximum claim 5% written down value. In relation to other classes, you could claim 20% written down value maximum. Now it's very clear what are those classes are. In item subsection 2 says, 1, where a depreciable asset owned by a person is only partly used in the production of income from a business at the end of the year of assessment, the cost of and consideration received for the asset shall be apportioned according to the market value of the part of the asset that is used in the production of income from the business. So, in capital allowance, item 2, subject to this paragraph, an allowance shall be granted to a person for a year of assessment for each of the person's depreciable assets equal to the depreciation for the year of the asset and calculated in accordance with the subsection 2. What is subsection 2? The depreciation for a year of assessment for each depreciable asset shall be calculated according to the straight line method using a following formula. You have to claim on the straight line method. What is the formula? A divided by B is something like accounting, no? Formula is given. So, accountants friendly, low. Where A is the depreciation base of the asset at the end of the year of assessment. That says something like a cost. Depreciation basis. It's further clarified later on. B, the number of years referred to in item 3. What is B? Item 3. The number of years could be class 1, 5 years. Class 2, 5 years. Class 3, 5 years. Class 4, that is a building, etc., 20 years. Class 5 is actually a life, useful life of the intangible asset, or where the intangible asset has an indefinite useful life, 20 years. So, you have to look at whether if the intangible asset has a useful life, then depreciate according to the useful life of the asset. If a lifetime is intangible, indefinite lifetime, then you can claim over 20 years. So, item 4 says, the restricted claim on the motor vehicles. Even this concept we had in the previous act also, but wording is slightly different. The no capital allowances shall be granted to a person in respect of a road vehicle. Idea is not to claim any capital allowance for road vehicles, but other than, so these vehicles are allowed. A commercial vehicle, it is defined further down the line. For the purpose of this paragraph, commercial vehicle means road vehicle designed to carry loads of more than half a ton or more than 13 passengers. The road vehicle which are designed to carry half a ton, that is 500 kilograms or 13 passengers, or vehicle used in the transportation or vehicle rental business. Any vehicles are used for transport business like a lorry, tractors, and or sometimes the van also, some businesses used for transportation. And also vehicle rental business. If your vehicle is used for hiring business, you could claim. These are the two items are covered under commercial vehicle. Then B, bus or minibus. C, good vehicles. Or heavy general purpose or specialized truck or trailers. So these are the four assets eligible. Other than these four assets, any road vehicle, any other road vehicle, the no capital allowances are due according to the fourth schedule. They come to depreciation basis of the depreciable asset. This amount on which you are going to claim capital allowances. For the depreciation base of a depreciable asset of a person at the end of the year of shall be the sum of mean total of A, the depreciation base of the asset at the end of the previous year of assessment, that is opening balance, plus B, amounts added to the depreciation base of the asset during the year of assessment in respect of addition to the cost of the asset. The addition would have been sometime the new purchase, or we discussed sometime before, excess repair and improvement costs could be added back. We worked on the example, can you remember? So opening balance plus any additions. If there's no additions, on the opening balance. Okay. So clause 1 deals with classification of depreciable asset. Clause 2 deal with the grant of capital allowances including the rates and the restricted assets, giving a formula A divided by B. C, how to calculate the depreciation base of the depreciable assets, also given. Look at question 44, application check 44. The applicable rates of capital allowance in respect to the following assets used by a person for the year of 1920. So, addition during the year 1920. The machinery of 650 million rupees, which include 10 million obtained under finance leasing. So all 60 million you can claim over how many years? Class 3 over 5 years period. 60 million divided by 5, 12 million, 12 million per annum. So the finance leasing asset also, according to section 49 subsection 2, it is considered the lessor is transferring ownership of the asset to the lessee. The lessee can claim capital allowance. Line with the accounting standard now. Equipment 2,500,000. Again over 5 years. You divide, don't apply percentage. Office furniture 2,400,000. Again over 5 years. CC to remember everything is 5 years except for class 4 and class 5. No? Computers and accessories again over 5 years. Building constructed You don't worry about whether the building, construct, or purchase, doesn't matter. In building, if you use for the business purposes, you can claim capital losses, no? The previous year, there was a criteria, qualifying building only you could claim it, or otherwise industrial building. Nothing like that here. Like other assets, same rule will apply for building also. If it's acquired and or owned and used for the business purposes, you can claim capital loss of the building, whether it's constructed or purchased, there's no difference. But you can claim class 4 assets over 20 years. Building purchased, again if you use it for business purpose, over 20 years. Software purchased 1,500,000. So the software is basically intangible, no? If your useful life is indefinite, you can claim over 20 years, otherwise, as per useful life of the asset. Look at the addition prior to 1st April 2018 under the previous act. Acquisition of software developed in Sri Lanka in May 2017, 1,800,000. You should have claimed under the previous act, local developed software 100% would have claimed in 2017-18. Therefore, nothing can be claimed in the current year through a transitional provision. Air conditioner purchase in 2017-18, 1,250,000. And the previous year, you should have claimed capital allowance of 20%. The balance capital allowance of 20% on the cost you can claim under the previous set, even for 1920 through a transitional provision. Sorry, it's air conditioner is not 20%, 33 1/3. The motor vehicle and furniture is 20% under the previous, I'm sorry. Okay? So another question, a newly incorporated company has acquired following assets which are classified as motor vehicle during the year of assessment 1920. The question is whether it can claim capital allowance on these motor vehicles, especially keeping in mind the restriction of claim of capital allowance for the road vehicles. Lorry purchased for transportation of goods. Yeah, it's a commercial vehicle. You got the definition? Deductible. Car purchase for drive directors, official and private traveling. It's a road vehicle, not coming under exceptional allowable road vehicles. Therefore, you can't claim. Car purchase or marketing director for his official travelling, can you claim? 100% official travelling, can you claim? No. Though used for business purpose, doesn't matter. Why? It is a road vehicle, unless the road vehicle is allowed under one of those four categories. Otherwise, any road vehicle you can't claim, even though it's used for business purposes. Then you can't claim. Car purchase for rental business, yeah, it's a commercial vehicle, clearly defined. So they basically given a example to understand the restriction of the road vehicles, claim of capital allowance. So basically, if you take up the substance, the cars are not allowed, no? Because they are road vehicle. It can be a commercial vehicle, but the certain situation, certain businesses, the car could be used for transportation or like a tourist transport travel agent companies, they might claim capital allowance on the motor car, tourist transport, or vehicle hiring companies, leasing companies, of course under the 49(2) they can claim now. So the companies can claim, certain company can claim capitalized on the motor cars, but generally they are the one you can't claim it because they are road vehicles. Now what we are discussing is section 16, capitalized claim under fourth schedule. Now look at the second schedule again. What is second schedule? Look at the heading of the second schedule, investment incentives. When the government introduced this new act, they want to bring certain incentive aiming the investment. That's the reason they are named as investment incentives, to promote the investment to the country. One of the benefit given is enhanced capital allowances. Enhanced capital allowances, what is enhanced capital allowances means? Increased capital allowances. Look at the second schedule, I am reading for you. Where a person invests in Sri Lanka, other than expense of the existing business, during year of assessment shall be granted enhanced capital allowances computed in accordance with this paragraph, in addition to the capital allowances computed under the fourth schedule. It's a double claim. What the criteria here? You are anyway entitled for the capital allowance of the fourth schedule. But in addition to that, you can claim capital allowances under second schedule also if the amount is invested in Sri Lanka, but not for the expansion of the existing business. If investment represent expanding the existing business, then you can't claim. For example, in a factory, you have a two machineries already using. You want to increase your capacity, you are going to buy a third machinery. So the third machinery you can't claim capital allowances on the second schedule. Why? You are trying to expand your existing business. You can't claim. So it should be a new investment, new business. That's a basic idea. There is a new company can claim, new business can claim. Even existing company investment in the new business, they could claim. How do you claim? Yeah, the criteria is given. A capital allowance of 100 million, 100% of the expense incurred by a person on depreciable assets other than intangible assets. Intangible left out for the purpose of second schedule. During a year of assessment shall be granted to that person for the year if the total expense incurred by the person during the year on depreciable asset other than the intangible asset that are used in a part of Sri Lanka other than northern province exceed $3 million but doesn't exceed $100 million. So minimum criteria here is $3 million. Okay, so if you invest on a depreciable asset other than intangibles, any part of Sri Lanka other than northern province, the whole cost you can claim as a capital allowances under second schedule. Your investment should exceed $3 million to less than $100 million. Okay, the next item, again other than northern province, if the investment is more than $100 million, you could claim 150% capital allowance. For example, if you invest 100 rupees, you can claim 150 rupees, more than the cost. These two are other than northern province. Why? For northern province, they are given more benefits. For northern province, item 4 says, the moment if you exceed $3 million investment on the depreciable asset other than intangibles, you can claim 200% of your cost as a capital loss. For example, if you claim, if you are incurred 1 billion rupees capital loss, capital cost investment, you can claim 2 billion, double claim in addition to the fourth schedule, remember. So basically the criteria is what? The northern province, they are given more tax benefits, no? The idea was to divert the investments to northern province. That's basically idea here. By item 5, about the claim of capital loss, so 150% of the expense incurred on buying the state companies. That's a minor thing. That's a provision here. So they are basically, it's clear the second schedule, one thing you have to be clearly keep in mind. This is applicable for investment in Sri Lanka, but in a business, capital asset, a depreciable asset, other intangible, but other than for the expense of the existing business. If investment represents expense of the existing business, then you can't claim. The minimum requirement is $3 million investment, depending on the location. Northern province, 200%. Other northern province, you could claim 100% or 150%, depending on the amount of investment. There is more than $3 million. Look at application check 16. Given a hypothetical example, the company which was newly incorporated in August 2018 to carry out the business of operation of a hotel in the district of Kandy. The new company to carry out the business in Kandy. The total project cost estimated to be 1,500 million. That includes cost incurred for land, 200 million. The company anticipates the completion of the project during the year of assessment 2021 and makes a substantial amount of profit from the operation, the first year itself. So company believes that it will have a substantial amount of income tax payable after deducting a capital loss under the fourth schedule, a huge profit. They are concerned about that. So the question comes here, can they claim the capital loss under the second schedule, enhanced capital loss? Yeah, it's a investment in depreciable asset. How much? 1,500 million minus 200 million. The land is not depreciable asset. As per the definition, so 1,300 million they could claim enhanced capital losses because that amount is more than $3 million. You could claim. The company can deduct enhanced capital losses given in second schedule under section 16 of the Act in respect of investment in depreciable assets equal to 100% cost in addition to capital losses granted under the fourth schedule. So the enhanced capital losses is going to be, see, the amount is invested in other northern province less than $100 million, then going to be 100% you can claim. So 1.3 billion amount of capital losses you can claim in 2021. Okay, it's a very huge benefit, you see. So that is the reason one should understand here, the new act, though there are no tax exemptions granted, the lot of benefits are given in the form of investment relief. That's a good thing. When you give a benefit with the investment, there's a growth will happen. So the main criteria for a tax benefit under the new act is the investment. If you invest it in a big projects, you could claim enhanced capital losses that will wipe off your liable profits, no? Okay? pipe out your liable profits. So now we claim the we discuss the capital allowance deduction under section 16. Capital allowances are allowed on the depreciable asset which are owned and used by the end of the year of assessment, calculated as per second or fourth schedule of the act. And also, if you go to 16, section 16, one more point I have to address you, subsection 2. Subsection 3. The capital allowance granted with respect to the particular year of assessment shall be taken in that year and shall not be deferred to a later year of assessment. You can't defer the claim of capital allowances. Very clear. So the question come, the claim of capital allowance is a must in that particular year, or you can postpone, defer. So it's very clear our test law, you can't defer, you have to claim it. Or what happens is sometime, the year in which you acquire the asset, if you have a exempt from income tax, you might wonder, rather than claiming the capital allowance against the exempt from it, better to postpone the claim. But you can you do that? No, you can't do. Sri Lankan tax law is very clear, no deferment for a claim of capital allowances. So now we'll come to the balancing allowance. Again, the same section. The balancing allowance also shall be deductible. What is balancing allowance? The balancing allowances are made in respect of depreciable assets realized during the year of assessment and in respect of which capital allowance has been granted in the year or an earlier year. That means any disposal comes, realization. For example, let's say if you sold your machinery during the year on which if you have already granted the capital allowances partly, then the balancing allowance, if you are workable, if according to second or fourth schedule, if you have any calculation of the balancing allowance, that amount is deductible for tax. What is actually this? Nothing else. We call this same thing under the previous set, the loss on disposal of the depreciable asset. No. That means we are, if you acquire a capital asset at the time of disposal, if a disposal value is less than the tax written down value, then what will happen? Your tax profit or tax loss? Tax loss. The tax loss amount can be deductible expense. This is balancing allowance. Correct word they are using, the balancing allowance. That means you are not unclaimed capital allowances amount after realization. You claim that amount a deductible expense under the heading balancing allowance. And also I would like to say, suppose if your disposal value is higher than my tax return value, your profit on disposal, how do you treat that? Yeah, that you already discussed under section 16, I'm sorry, section 6, assessable charge. I think item section 6D, you could claim. You tax the under as a business income under section 6 item. D. 6 subsection 2 item D. Then we call assessable charge, no? When I discuss the business income, inclusion, the exclusion, we discuss that part. We'll work out the example. Look at the first several balancing elements. The page 216. Yeah. The balancing elements and assemble charge both work together. Clause 4. Yeah, A minus B. What is aim? A is a consideration received. B test written value at the end of the real at the time of realization. Year of disposal or year of realization, you can't claim capital allowances. But the rule for claiming capital allowance is what? The answer should be there at the end of the year of assessment. They are the year of acquisition, you can claim capital allowances, but not the year of disposal. Even a sale value is higher than my written down value, then A minus B, positive amount, that we take as a assessable charge to be taxable as business income under section 6, subsection 2, item D. But here, if B is higher than A, if the test written down value is higher than my sale value or disposal value, I have a loss. That amount you can claim as a deductible expense under section 16. Are you clear? Same thing is given for second schedule also, the balancing elements and the assessable charge. Page number 208. But I think that when you come to second schedule, I don't think there can be a balancing elements, because the claim of capital elements under the second schedule always what? Increased amount. You can total amount you are claiming, max minimum you can claim is 100%, no? It could be 100% of the cost or 150% or 200%. So once you claim it, there can't be written on value. For you to have a sale value is less than written down value. Of course, you can have assessable charge, but there might not be a balancing elements. Anyway, the law provides for them. Look at the application check 47. The tax adjustment in relation to the realization of following asset during the year of FASB 1920. Take example, the company sold a machinery for 8 million, which was acquired on 14 September 2017 for 12 million. The book written down value of the asset at the time of disposal is 5,500,000. So, look at the facts here. Machinery which acquired in September 2017 for 12 million. Was sold in 1924 8 million. At the time of disposal, you are accounting written down value was 5,500,000. What do you do? First, you would have accounted the profit from the disposal for accounting purpose. No, you must cancel out that. Remove the book profit 2,500,000. What is 2,500,000? So 8 million minus, look at the, if you work out the disposal account, as accountant you can easily find out, sale value is 8 billion minus 5,500,000, you have an accounting profit of 2,500,000 would have been credited to the income statement. You remove that one, minus side. Work out your assessable charge or balancing elements. How do you do? Compare the sale value with the written down value. In this case, you have a 4 million profit that you tax as assessable charge. How do you work out the 4 million? Your sale value, disposal value 4 million, 8 million minus written down value at the time of disposal. Your cost was 12 million. You have already claimed capital allowance under the previous set, 33 and 1/3 over 2 years. That means 8 million you have already claimed. the 4 million remaining unclaimed capital allowances, written down value. So 8 billion sale value minus written down value 4 million, you have 4 million profit that we call assessable charge. So that amount should be taxable under section 6 subsection 2 item D in calculating my business income. So are you clear? Look at the end of the example. A lorry sold for 1 million was acquired on August 19, 2017 for 4 million. The book written down value of the asset at the time of disposal was 2,500,000. Here again we work out, remove the accounting loss, accounting wise loss. Why? Your sale value 1 million, your written down value for accounting purpose 2,500,000. It is less. So 1,500,000 accounting loss would have been charged to the income statement. You add back that one first. When you work out your tax A minus B, not A minus B, B minus A. Written down value is higher than my sale value. The sale value for 1 million rupees, what was my written down value? Would I claim capital allowances for 20% in 17-18 and 18-19? 17-18 under the previous set, 18-19 through a transitional provision. So would I claim 800,000 rupees out of 4 million? I claim already 4 million 20%, 1,600,000. The cost was 4 million. I already claim 4 million for 20% over 2 years capital allowances. So 2,400,000 is my written down value. 4 million minus 1,600,000. So written down value is 2,400,000. So 1 million minus 2,400,000, you have a loss of 1,400,000. That is we call assessable charge, covered within the scope of section 16. You can claim as a deductible expense in calculating my business income. That is very clear. If you have assessable charge, positive amount, profit, you tax under business income under section 6. If a balancing allowance like this, allow that amount as a deductible expense under section 16. Are you clear? Should be specific deductions. The losses on realization of business assets and liability, section 17, next item. For the purpose of calculating the person's income from business, loss from the realization of any assets and liabilities shall be deducted. Realization of any loss coming from the realization of assets and liability should be deductible. What is this loss? Losses are calculated as per chapter 4. Chapter 4, we will discuss next day, capital gain chapter. This will be applicable. Consideration is series less than the cost of the asset. Go to chapter 4, there will be a loss on disposal. Of what? Assets and liability of the business. What asset? If you go to section 17, it says, can you go to section 17 please? Though it's used the word asset here, the subparagraph clearly says it's a capital asset of the business. Capital asset, there's a definition given. We already looked at. You go to under section 195. land building, etc. Capital asset of the business, which is used in the business purposes. We dispose if your losses comes up. If you have a gain, you tax that gain under business income. Under section 6, subsection 2, item B, I believe. Item C, 6 subsection 2, item C, is other side of this. If you have gain, you tax under section 6, subsection 2, item C. If you have losses, you deduct it under section 17. Similarly, when you are realizing a liability of the business also, not all the normal liability, business liability, clarify further. What is business liabilities? That means the liabilities obtained for the business purposes. When realizing a liability, we discussed other day capital gain topic, how do you realize the liability, how do you calculate the gain or loss. If you are realizing a liability, if you have losses, again, if you have gain, you must tax under section 6, subsection 2 and item C. If you have losses, you can claim the same corresponding loss under section 17. Then short, any capital assets and liability of the business, if you realize, if you have a gain, you must tax under business income that we already discussed. But if you have losses, you must claim under section 17 of the Act. Okay. Then look at the section 18, deductible amount of financial cost. So, maximum ceiling of claim. Normally, we call this thin capitalization rule. Thin capitalization is subject of financial management. Now, before I come to this, I would like to say first, can you claim the financial cost or interest cost? Yes, we discuss section 12, no? Can you go to section 12, please? Yeah, account to section 12. Certain interests are deemed to be incurred in the production of income. For the purpose of section 11, where borrowing is used to acquire the asset, asset is used in the production of income. Or, in any other case, the debt capital is used for the business purposes, no? Then the interest costs served on the debt capital is deductible under section 12 as a specific deduction. But now she is saying, but under this rule, there is a maximum ceiling you can claim the financial cost. For the claim of financial cost, the amount of financial cost deducted in calculating the entity's income from conducting a business or investment shall not exceed the amount of financial cost attributable to financial instrument within the limit as given below. So that means this ceiling is applicable under this section 18. You are given a maximum financial cost deductible. If the actual amount is more than the maximum amount deductible, the excess you can't claim under section 18. But this rule doesn't apply for financial institutions. Why? With the bank and financial companies, if you are going to apply this rule, what will happen? They have a huge problem, no? But they are major part of the expense of interest cost on deposits and borrowings, no? So, for the banking and financial institutions, the financial institution defined the general definition of section 195. For them, it is not applicable. So, what is the limit? Limit of what? Interest deduction or borrowing, financial instruments. The limit is given for financial instruments. What is the maximum limit? A multiplied by B. What is A? Total issued share capital and reserves B, the case of manufacturing entity. Number 3, the case of other entities, other manufacturer. Number 4. So, if you are a manufacturing entity, 3 times then the share capital reserve. That is the maximum debt capital on which you can claim interest cost. For example, your interest, if you have equity capital, if a share capital reserve, let's say 100 million rupees, you can maximum claim 300 million rupees if you are a manufacturer on the debt capital, the interest cost. But if you are a non-manufacturer, you can maximum claim 400 million. In excess debt capital interest cost, you can't claim for tax purposes. It's a very important rule, you know, not for the tax purposes, you know, to mitigate the risk of liquidity, you know. Otherwise, normally in the financial management theory, we would have learned gearing ratio, you know, 1:1 generally. If equity capital is 1, debt capital should be 1. Am I right? But here you are given a 3 times if you are a manufacturer. If equity capital is 1, you can claim 1 to 3 interest cost you can claim. High borrowing, still out. If a non-manufacturer, 1 to 4, still allowed. So obviously non-manufacturer you can claim more than the manufacturer. Why is that? Is something wrong? Normally the tax benefit should be granted to the manufacturer, not for the other person. Why they are restricted for the manufacturer only 3 times, non-manufacturer 4 times? Yeah, the idea here is to protect the business, that's the idea, not to give the benefit. So manufacturer should be protected from high gearing. So that is the idea. That's why I said here. This is not a tax law, it's a basic account, it's a financial management theory. In order to safeguard the manufacturer, you are given only 3 times. Don't have more than 3 times. You are high risky. For non-manufacturer, you can go for 4 times. No problem. Up to 4 times interest cost you can claim. Or the debt capital interest cost you can claim. Okay? Any section 18 subsection 3 says if actual expenses are more than the 3 times or 4 times of the debt capital, the excess may be carried forward to the subsequent year of assessment up to 6 years of assessment. What is 6 years of assessment? What is the logic on that? Yeah, look at the section 19 later on. After this we discussed the business loss you can carry forward only for 6 years. The same rule will apply here also, right? Okay. The definition given, what do you mean by financial institutions? For them, it's not applicable. Financial institution means any company or body of persons carrying on a banking business and includes a licensed specialized bank within the meaning of Banking Act. A non-banking financial institution regulated in the same way as a bank in paragraph A. Or any other category person as we prescribed. You could be understanding there is no any other category prescribed by the Commissioner General. Reserves doesn't include or excludes reserve arising from the revaluation of an asset. Why is this? Otherwise, in order to mitigate your problem of claimability, you can quickly increase your reserve, no, by revaluing your asset. Can you do that one? No. The revaluation, the reserve you must take excluding revaluation reserve of the asset. Okay? That would be basic revenue reserve you can take. I'm not sure about this is a not applicable place here. this part, section 18 is subsection 4. As you know, the section 18 is a thin capillation rule whereby the maximum ceiling is given for a claimability of interest cost. But this is something else. According to section 18, subsection 4, it gives the certain circumstances in which the losses from the financial instrument to be set off against the gain from the financial instruments. Where the Commissioner General may specify the instances in which the losses on the financial instrument may be set off against the gain on the financial instruments. So, as per the gazette notification issued referring the 2064/55 dated April 1st, 2018, he has specified the circumstances. What are the circumstances? The loss on the financial instrument is occurred, the circumstances in which the loss on this financial instrument set off against the gain from the same type of financial instruments. I mean, the losses from the one financial instrument should be set off against the gain from the same financial instruments. The losses from the one financial instrument cannot be set off against the gain from the another financial instruments. You have to match the same type of financial instruments to set off the loss against the gain. Okay. I don't know whether this is not applicable place to apply this section. I think should have been mentioned somewhere else anyway. For financial instruments also defined under section 195, it's a dedicated section to define the financial instruments definition. Look at the application check 48. A breakup of the financial cost incurred by a company which engages in business of manufacturing during the year of 1920 is given below. So, the cost of the interest cost of the manufacturing company is given. Loan from the holding company 160 million with the interest cost is 28,800,000. Loan from banks 400 million amount, interest cost 60 million. Overdraft 100 million, interest cost 25 million. Debenture cost 200 million, the amount is 200 million, interest cost 40 million. So, total debt capital, financial instruments amount 860 million, interest cost 153,800,000. But the question come here. How much you can claim out of 153,800,000? Can you claim the whole amount? Yeah, generally all amounts are covered, assuming all amounts are the business oriented interest covered under section 12, you can claim, but now you can't claim the whole amount subject to the incapitalization rule. Let's say company's equity statement, the share capital is 50 million. Retained profits, revenue reserve 150 million. So, reserve from the revaluation of asset 30 million. So, altogether 230 million. But 30 million you can't take, as you know, it's not a part of the reserve. You have to revaluation asset, revaluation of reserve coming from the revaluation of asset should be excluded. You must add only the share capital plus reserve other than revaluation reserve from the asset. So, then only 200 million. So, how much maximum you can claim out of 200 million? Yeah, if you are a manufacturer, 3 times. Total debt capital asset 31st March 2020, 860 million. So, law is not so clear the debt capital asset when. It's another problem in the law. The previous asset was clearly given at the end of the year of assessment. So, on that basis, I have worked out. Otherwise, you should have take up an average amount or opening amount or closing amount, average amount. It's more prudent to take average amount, but then you have to work out some calculation, no? I think the idea is here is like the previous set. They omitted. I think they should have been some amendment here. 860 million debt capital. But share capital reserves as of 31st March 2020 plus 3 into 3, 200 million into 3 times 60 million maximum. So the excess debt amount is to 260 million. The interest cost attributable to 260 million excess debt will not be allowable under Section 18. Pro rata basis, when you worked out 153,800,000 is total interest cost that is relevant to total debt capital of 860 million. Work out applicable amount of interest cost relevant to 260 million excess debt. The answer is 46,497,674. That is the amount of interest cost you can't claim. The balance interest cost will be deductible anyway. Okay. So again, there is a question here, who is a manufacturer and unmanaged, how do you decide? The previous there was a definition for these purposes, manufacturer and unmanufacturer, but here not defined. So in substance, if the company is a manufacturer, you can take as a manufacturer here. And also when you compare the previous act, we had a thing capitalization rule, but a partial thing capitalization. The rule was applicable for a intercompany loan interest only. That means we had a thing capitalization, but it's a partial. Now only we have a full thing capitalization rule. Okay. Take a debt capital total, whether intercompany loan or outside does, banker doesn't matter. Total interest bearing financial instrument you must take into account for calculating the thing capitalization rule. Okay.